think when you look at this in terms of the numbers, thousands infected, well over 1,500 dead, when you compare it to all the other national disasters, Hillsborough and the Birmingham bombings, Grenfell, the scandal that happened with factor concentrates eclipses all of them combined, yet it's never had that recognition.
It is difficult to imagine the feelings of unfairness that people must feel at being infected with something like hepatitis C or HIV as a result of a totally unrelated treatment within the NHS.
I'm giving evidence on what happened to my father, two uncles and my cousin, hopefully get their story out.
This is the last chance we will be able to speak for him. After all these years and all the suffering, we need to find the truth.
Speaker, they would urgently compensate haemophiliacs who have contracted the HIV virus.
I believe that this scandal amounts to a criminal cover-up on an industrial scale.
I think that the Department of Health are 100% responsible for this.
I've been part of the greatest medical disaster to have affected the NHS.
The very first factor VIII that I had, that was the contaminated batch.
I know that in America, drug addicts were selling their blood.
When you hear the words HIV, you're dead.
He was scared, wasn't he? He used to say how frightened he was.
I'd definitely seen enough to know that what happened is a scandal and that there was a cover-up.
There's a finger on the front.
Yeah, you've got the
what, too long? Oh, sorry. Makes a lot of difference.
Are you proud of your new baby, Sandra and John?
We certainly are.
And what have you called him?
Jason.
Jason.
Evans.
JJ.
JJ for sure.
When I was born, you know, the whole AIDS thing was at its peak. And in terms of the fear and the stigma, and all that sort of thing. And obviously, they were relieved my mum wasn't infected. They were relieved I wasn't infected. On my birth sheet where it says like how much you weigh, and all that sort of thing, has got a big biohazard mark on it, like on my birth sheet. And it says HIV test. You know, day I was born, I had a HIV test. The scandal has existed in my life since the day I was born. It's always been there from day one. This is never gonna go away for me. This is the paperwork that I've been collecting for years through freedom of information requests, by trawling archives, friends in other countries that have managed to get documents from archives there and send them over. So it's all here in one place. The simplest version of this story is a product that was known to be dangerous was released, the harm became evident, it was covered up, and the people impacted by it had been denied any sense of truth or justice ever since.
We welcome this public inquiry. This is the beginning of a journey to uncover exactly what happened and why. But from those I represent, it begins with an expression of sorrow and regret. Many of those who have suffered contamination with infected blood or blood products, their affected families and friends, do not trust the Department of Health. There's been repeated mention of the destruction of documents, both government papers and medical records. There have been eloquent statements about breaches of trust experienced, as well as many reminders of what may, at worst, have been a cover-up, or at best, a lack of candor about past events.
My father's death's been recorded falsely in history as an accident, and it wasn't. So firstly, I want that put right. In the last decade, you know, 200 people with just HIV have passed away. Add in the numbers of hepatitis C, and we're where we are today of one victim every 4 days.
What cannot be forgiven is cover-up. Information is key, knowledge is key. By denying them that knowledge for so many years caused untold misery, death and God knows what else, because they chose not to tell us. That's wrong. That needs to be addressed.
If I had infected him with an injection of Factor VIII that was contaminated, I would have been put away for murder. And instead, we've done a life sentence for what they'd done to him.
Every one of us that's still about has survivor's guilt. Mm. Because we've lost so many friends. Mm. You've lost handfuls of friends.
I stopped counting at 40.
Mm. 1,200 haemophiliacs were co-infected, and there's only about just over 200 left. We've lost almost 1,000 people, 1,000 close friends. They were my family.
Haemophilia is a rare complaint affecting men. There are 4,500 sufferers in Britain. All lack the vital clotting ingredient in their blood, which prevents internal bleeding and crippling damage to their joints.
I remember quite a lot of pain. It hurt. Haemophilia did hurt. I fell out of a tree, scrumping for apples, and was in an induced coma for a week with a head bleed.
I know I've died twice and come back.
The first stage of blood separation involves the use of a centrifuge. The red cells fall to the bottom. The yellow plasma is at the top. The plasma is then drained, leaving behind a valuable component called cryoprecipitate.
Cryoprecipitate really was the real first big breakthrough in haemophilia treatment.
Cryoprecipitate is just one of a number of components which can be separated. This precipitate must be thawed in warm water. Up to 6 packs will be needed for one treatment.
It was often given in a hospital. If you were going to use it at home, it would have to be kept in the deep freeze and thawed out, and that could take some time. When Factor VIII concentrate came in, that changed.
For haemophiliacs, the turning point in their lives was the British discovery of Factor VIII concentrate. It is derived from plasma, the straw-coloured liquid which carries the red and white blood cells through the body.
Factor VIII is a protein found within the bloodstream that assists in blood clotting.
It was only in the early 1970s that a way was found of concentrating Factor VIII from blood so that it could be given as a concentrate.
Factor VIII revolutionized life for the haemophiliac. He could treat himself at home. Factor VIII became a passport to a more normal life.
Was it a bit of a game-changer when Factor VIII came along?
Yes, definitely.
It was an evolution, is the word, in treatment.
It was definitely seen as a wonder drug. You know, literally within half an hour, your bleeding had stopped.
Now I'll just go straight to the fridge where I've got a constant supply of Factor VIII, then I'll just inject myself.
Factor VIII is, you know, was what we'd always wanted. It was just a concentrate in a little freeze-dried bottle and a pack. You pull it out of the fridge, add some sterile water, mix it up in 5 minutes, draw it up through a filter into a syringe, and inject it through a vein in the back of your hand, which takes 5 minutes. Job done.
I used to administer it 2 or 3 times a week to Lee.
Thought it was good.
Yeah, we thought it was good.
In England, when Factor VIII concentrate came in, the Blood Products Laboratory, which created British Factor VIII from volunteer donors in this country, did not have the capacity to create enough Factor VIII for all patients with haemophilia. And so the decision was made to begin importing Factor VIII from the USA.
Blood and plasma products like Factor VIII are big business in America. Since 1970, Baxter's net profits have grown from £7.17 million to £18.14 million last year.
Travenol, Baxter, Armour and Bayer were kind of the big suppliers of the commercial Factor VIII from the US. And in the USA, things were different to in this country because people were paid for their plasma donations. The problem, and it had been long understood, that when you pay someone for their blood or their plasma, you provide the person with a motive to lie about their medical history, their lifestyle, and things that could make them a viral risk.
This is the city's Skid Row, home to many alcoholics and down and outs. Here we found the Highland Donor Centre.
Many of these plasma centres were set up in, you know, poverty-stricken areas where you have high levels of IV drug abuse, high levels of prostitution. You had extremely high resources.
What sort of evidence is there that shows the degree of risk that you run if you use blood taken from paid donors?
The risk runs from 6 to 70 times greater than worthy donors, all from a volunteer source.
The American blood product companies were bleeding prisoners, they were bleeding people who were clearly from the sort of lower end of society. We were right to be concerned about the quality of blood donor that was being used to get into American Factor VIII and then being shipped to Britain for doctors like me to give to our patients.
The pooling thing is so important. It takes one person who is infected with HIV, for example, to infect an entire batch, which is then processed down into hundreds, maybe thousands of vials of Factor VIII, which can then infect literally thousands of people.
Right from the very start of concentrate usage in 1972-73, huge numbers of studies were done, all finding very similar things, that patients regularly treated with Factor VIII with severe haemophilia had a pattern of liver function that looked like hepatitis.
Since April 1974, there's been an unprecedented outbreak of hepatitis among haemophiliacs. New evidence from three American studies links concentrates with subsequent liver damage. Nearly 60 cases have been traced so far, including two which may have contributed to the deaths of those haemophiliacs.
At that time, there were only two types of hepatitis known about, hepatitis A and B, and they didn't have either of those. So it was suggested that there might be a third type of hepatitis, which we originally called non-A, non-B. This was the virus that 15 years later was isolated as hepatitis C. Somebody who was very influential at that time, who was the health minister, was David Owen, who was a doctor. He was leading this initiative in the Department of Health to try and get us to be self-sufficient in Factor VIII, relying on donor plasma from Britain, which in essence involved building a new plant.
Last January, Government Minister Dr. David Owen allocated £500,000 to speed up plasma collection.
The limitation on our build-up is one of buildings, equipment, and having a larger volume. But I've tried to make this switch to self-sufficiency as quickly as possible, and I share some of your feelings that I wish it had been made in 1971, 72, or even earlier than that.
Frustratingly, he made so much progress that decisions were made for it to happen. The DOH even held a press conference, and then he left the department to become Foreign Secretary. And after that, things seemed to not go forward for reasons that are still not clear.
The whole thing was a disaster waiting to happen.
Concentrate usage just went up and up and up and up. In the UK, we're still importing millions of units of this product on an annual basis. In 1980, we're looking at 57.7 million units of Factor VIII concentrate are being used. We got, in 1981, that's going up to 65.7 million.
People had enough information, I think, to say this is not sensible to have to rely on commercial imports from the US, from donors who were clearly more likely to have viruses. This is not a sensible thing to be doing. And somebody at the DOH should have made that decision by the mid-1970s, as other countries did.
I was working as a nurse. I remember reading about haemophiliacs being infected with blood products in America, and I was a staunch believer that the UK, it would not happen. You know, we wouldn't be taking our blood from people that we knew was contaminated. It just wouldn't happen. And I truly, truly believe that.
That's what I could never believe, even in the 60s and 70s.
I think I convinced him as well. You'll be absolutely fine.
In the 60s and 70s, I know that in America, drug addicts were selling their blood. Never in a million years would I have thought that the government would have even contemplated about buying any blood products from someone who was giving it to, you know, who was selling it. I mean, it's disgusting.
I started at Trelawes, obviously, in 81, this would be. There were two schools, lower and the upper school, at Trelawes, and you weren't treated at the lower school for anything. You had to go to the upper school via what they called the hemo van. And that's how we all met, wasn't it?
A specialist haemophilia centre was set up around 76, 77. It was run entirely by the NHS. It had nothing to do with the Trelaw Trust and the Trelaw College. It was a separate entity. Although it was physically attached to the college, it was an NHS unit.
if we fast forward onto 1981 at Trelaw, you would get nervous because for all of us, we'd already had hepatitis two, three times by this point. So you're getting a bit worried about the stuff that is going into your vein. The doctor at the Trelaw Centre said, you've got a little bit of non-A, non-B there. Don't worry about it. It's not for you to ever worry about. Don't worry about it. Back to school. It was such a non-event.
In 1980, we've got Diana Walford, who's a senior official in the Department of Health, and in this document, she's copied in a number of health officials, about 10 or so, in reference to non-A, non-B hepatitis. She says, this form of hepatitis can be rapidly fatal, particularly when acquired by patients with pre-existing liver disease, or can lead to progressive liver damage. She's one of the most senior officials dealing with this issue in the Department of Health at the time, copying in a number of others, demonstrating that this is the case. This virus is in these products and it's a potentially fatal condition.
This would now be the end of the 1970s. There was evolving evidence that this third hepatitis virus could go on to cirrhosis and liver failure and very severe illness. And while these dialogues were going on right at the end of the 1970s, then, out of the blue, we got AIDS.
AIDS has primarily struck homosexuals in major cities like New York, Los Angeles, and San Francisco. AIDS was quickly dubbed the gay plague.
The disease has now spread to other segments of society. Patients such as this young haemophiliac are particularly at risk.
Well, that dreaded new disease, AIDS, has now reached Britain.
May 1983, this is a Department of Health memo. We have the first case of AIDS in a haemophiliac in the UK. And it clearly says here he's been treated with American Factor VIII.
A small number of haemophiliacs are reported as having this new disease, which looks as if it can be in the blood supply. We're not yet able to test our patients because there's no blood test available.
Research is aimed at finding out what causes AIDS, but at present, no one really knows. The disease is probably caused by a virus, and it can almost certainly be passed on from one person to another in blood or blood products.
That news was assimilated very quickly, and then we said, what do we do? The answer to which was not clear. Choices are, starkly, do you not treat people with severe haemophilia and risk them dying of cerebral bleeding, or do you accept these theoretical, as they were, concerns and carry on? And it wasn't much of a choice.
The point is, haemophiliacs absolutely have to be treated for their bleeding problems, and I'm sure it raises all kinds of questions about what do I do now?
I think everybody's a little scared. Is this the infusion that's going to give it to me? I'm not ready to give up the benefits of concentrate yet.
If you're a haemophiliac, mild or severe, if you have a head injury, that can be fatal. I think there's a bit of a misconception
Definitely.
With regards to haemophilia and the whole notion that if you weren't treated, you would bleed to death. It's just nonsense.
And it was just utterly untrue. Doctors have said it recently, that, well, the haemophilia care would have just fallen apart. Well, would it? If we didn't take Factor VIII, we would have more joint damage, but we wouldn't be dead. They could have shown us a different way.
They could have given us the choice, couldn't
they? Yeah, it's a choice, the informed choice.
They'd given us the choice with all the information that they knew.
American doctors researching into the disease suspect that it may be transmittable by blood used in transfusions and also by medical supplies made from blood. One of these is Factor VIII, which is used to treat the otherwise uncontrollable bleeding of haemophiliacs.
In the US, the CDC are becoming aware that there's this new condition. Bruce Evatt was one of the key people in ringing the alarm bell over AIDS. Beginning of 1983, we're still importing millions of units of Factor VIII. Bruce Evatt writes to Professor Arthur Bloom, chairman of the Haemophilia Center Directors, also sitting on the Haemophilia Society's medical advisory panel. One of the two key haemophilia doctors in this country at the time. Bruce Evatt writes to Arthur Bloom and tells him, we presently have 13 confirmed haemophiliac patients with AIDS in the United States. He goes on to say that the incidence rate has been increasing in haemophiliacs, and he says that all of them have received Factor VIII concentrates. On the second page, he actually says, I suspect it is a matter of time before you begin to see cases in the United Kingdom. So, here in March 1983, Bruce Evatt has clearly warned Arthur Bloom that AIDS is coming to the UK in Factor VIII. Months later, in May of 83, Professor Arthur Bloom pens a statement for the Haemophilia Society, and this statement goes out to patients. It opens up by saying, in view of the unduly alarmist report on AIDS, and then it goes on, the cause of AIDS is quite unknown. It has not been proven to result from transmission of a specific infective agent in blood products. He says it would be counterproductive to alter our treatment programs. And so this whole statement, really, Professor Bloom and the Haemophilia Society together are saying there's no proof or anything, and essentially we're not going to do anything.
Are British sufferers from this condition worried about AIDS, as your American counterparts seem to be?
Yes, of course we're worried, but at the moment we don't want to panic yet.
But the worry is there, and people know that the American community, haemophilia community, is anxious.
Certainly.
Tell me about Factor VIII.
The Haemophilia Society was, they send out a
bulletin
magazine
every month, or whatever it was,
every couple of months.
Yeah.
So they would say, you know, in there about it's not to worry about it, and but you do, once you've been told you not to worry about it, you do worry, because why are they mentioning it? So that's why we questioned with our consultant about the Factor VIII and how safe it was. And we kept questioning, didn't we?
Every time you went in, I believe.
We would ask, and he would, oh, the only answer we got was, you know as much as I know. And that was all he would say to us, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Mum phoned the Haemophilia Society and said, is there anything wrong or to be concerned about in Adrian's treatment? They said, no, Mrs. Goodyear, carry on as normal. It's fine.
There were some voices who were sort of expressing some significant disquiet about the fact that the risks were being played down or not acknowledged, or that there wasn't acceptance that this virus could be transmitted through blood.
In May 1983, this is a UK warning. Dr. Galbraith, a senior medical person at the CDSC in this country, warning the Department of Health I've reviewed the literature and come to the conclusion that all blood products made from blood donated in the USA after 1978 should be withdrawn from use until the risk of AIDS transmission by these products has been clarified. And they fell on deaf ears.
Let me turn to Dr. Peter Jones. Dr. Jones, as a doctor, what do you say to haemophiliacs you treat? Presumably you are very keen that they should continue to take this Factor VIII treatment.
We have absolutely no doubt at all that the benefits are far greater than the risk, if the risk is actually there. If we put this into perspective, you've already said there are 4,000 to 5,000 people with haemophilia in the United Kingdom. To date, there has only been one, despite what the newspapers say, one suspected, not confirmed case of AIDS in a person with haemophilia in the United Kingdom. This is a very minor infection. If it is an infection, we don't have any proof that it's coming through blood. It's been blown up out of all proportion by the press, and the Blood Transfusion Service, my colleagues there, and the Haemophilia Centre directors are in no doubt whatsoever that everything continues for the moment as at present.
Committee on Safety of Medicines is there to decide on which medicines, which products, which procedures are suitable and acceptable for provision to the public. Now, it's a very, very important task which it sets itself, and there will be a lot of considerations which have to be taken into account. You can't imagine that there wouldn't be.
At this meeting in July 1983, this question on can AIDS be transmitted through blood products is addressed. We've got some haemophilia doctors, we've got some people from the Department of Health. They say patients who repeatedly receive blood clotting factor concentrates appear to be at risk. So they're acknowledging the risk of AIDS inherent in Factor VIII. But at this point in time, they said they don't deem it to be great enough to take action. And so they continued to license the product and allow the products to be used throughout the UK.
If you know something is likely to cause you harm, if you've reached a decision that that is probably the case, then surely there's a duty and obligation to communicate that to the public.
So did any of your doctors ever tell you about the risks associated with Factor VIII?
No. Never.
We were never told about any risks associated with Factor VIII. All we were told was how good it was.
Either they thought that we were too young to have that conversation, or the hospitals didn't think that it was necessary to have that conversation. But I know for a fact that none of these conversations ever took place.
So here we've got these conclusions and recommendations have been reached. It's acknowledged that there is a risk of AIDS inherent in these products. And following on from that meeting, we then see this letter. And this is written by Joseph Smith, who was director at the National Institute for Biological Standards and Control. And he writes to Arthur Bloom. And he says, "I am afraid that it is necessary to ask that the recommendations remain confidential, largely because of the commercial implications." From Joe Smith.
For there to be an indication in the papers which arose as a result of that meeting that commercial implications are a factor doesn't speak well of that meeting and indeed the actions which they didn't take following the meeting. We don't live in a commercial free world. So, I mean, I don't know what the commercial considerations were. I mean, it could have been that the health service had signed up to take X million pounds worth of this stuff. No one knows. That was never made clear at the time. It hasn't been made clear now. But that said, on any basis, it appears that the commercial considerations here overrode the obligation of the Department of Health to communicate the risks involved between HIV factor products and haemophilia sufferers.
Right up until the end of 1983, the official government answer was there is no conclusive evidence that AIDS can be transmitted by Factor VIII. We see Ken Clark, health minister at the time, repeating this line to Parliament that there's no conclusive evidence that AIDS is transmitted through blood products because there was not yet a public test. And being able to say there's no conclusive proof, whilst technically true, I think to the average person suggests there's no proof. And so it all comes back to that question, at what point do you do something decisive to stop this before it happens?
They knew and they had research that certain viruses, including the hepatitis viruses, were all transmitted through blood and blood products, and so they'd known that from the early 70s. The fact that they had no test for this new supervirus that was coming through cannot lead you to the conclusion that we don't have conclusive proof. Because, I mean, really, all you should be looking for is a suspicion that it may happen.
At the end of 1983 in November, in The Guardian, it's reported we have the first haemophiliac in Britain to die of AIDS as a result of Factor VIII. In response to that news clipping from the Department of Health, we can see there was a question asked here by a civil servant. Is it okay for us to continue to say there is no conclusive proof that the disease is being transmitted by blood products? The answer given to that question is yes, it is okay. And so we can only infer from this the government policy here is to just carry on doing what we're doing despite the amount of people that are at risk now.
You can look at this and say, until we had a test for hepatitis C or HIV, what could have been done? But really, this is less about the testing and more about the viral inactivation that could have happened. Because the way that you make Factor VIII safe from viruses is by heating it, the heat treatment process. HIV-free Factor VIII was available as early as 1983.
Well, I started as a haemophilia centre director in 1983, just when all the problems with viruses were getting going. Several companies were evaluating the possibility of treating Factor VIII with heat treatment as a way of getting rid of viruses. There was experimental evidence if you heated Factor VIII that was spiked with a virus in the laboratory, it got rid of it.
We have a document here from June of 1983, and this is being sent from the Blood Transfusion Service to the Department of Health. And it's in relation to a letter advertising the fact they've now got this heat-treated Factor VIII product in 1983. There was a lot of resistance because of worry about whether or not the heat treatment did work. But the internal discussion within the British Health Service was really largely based on cost grounds. We see here that they're talking about if demands are made for its use by the haemophilia directors or possibly the patients themselves, if they hear or read about it, it will play havoc with the regional health authorities' finances. It's almost like they don't want patients to even know that there's a heat-treated product in existence because of how much it might cost. In response to that letter, the Department of Health writes back on the 1st of July 1983, and whilst they say that the cost implications wouldn't be material to their decision, they also say that your comments about the potentially major financial consequences for health authorities could be used to support the argument for properly controlled clinical trials before such material is introduced into this country. You know, we don't really see anything here about this could be good for safety, this might prevent infections. It's really mostly about the cost.
By the end of 1983, beginning of 1984, the blood product companies approached us as haemophilia doctors and said, we can get you heat-treated Factor VIII. Now, this was not licensed, but doctors are able to use unlicensed products in Britain if it's on what's called a named patient basis. For a few years at the height of the crisis, the haemophilia doctors actually were responsible for their own purchasing. It was down to you to buy Factor VIII. You were given a budget. There was only one type of heat-treated product available, and that was the American one. Unlicensed, 50% more expensive. The really critical question was, would a haemophilia doctor want to use, totally based on experimental theory, this new heat-treated Factor VIII? And there were two schools of thought. I made a decision to use the heat-treated Factor VIII, and we were able to switch in May 1984 to heat-treated for all our patients. An awful lot of haemophilia directors formed a view that they would not use heat-treated American. And whether you got heat-treated American unlicensed depended on which part of the country you lived in. And that was not satisfactory.
What do you say to criticisms that haemophiliacs are exposed to the risk of AIDS from imported American blood because the government hasn't provided enough funds to make Factor VIII in England?
I find them quite inexplicable because in the middle of all the attempts that we've been making to deal with this very worrying problem, the one thing we haven't done is starve the factory, as we call it at Elstree, of the necessary funds.
The government said that Factor VIII in Britain will be heat-treated to try and kill the AIDS virus. Why can't that be done sooner than next April?
The board who've run this service have just announced that they think we ought to do that. We're taking expert advice on whether heat treatment will be a proper protection against AIDS or whether some other method will be more effective. Obviously, we're as anxious as everybody else to sort that out, see whether heat treatment's effective, and then have a look at the practicality of doing it.
Thank you.
I believe that they didn't invest in the heated product as early as they could have done because of cost. Had they have gone down that road, I believe that my father would never have contracted HIV. He was never warned, he was never told of the risks. These people should have been told straight away. You know, as soon as they had any inclination of there might be HIV in this, regardless of whether they knew what it was or not, people should have been told.
They withheld the risks that community had faced and continued to face by continuing to use non-heat treated products, even though they knew that the non-heat treated products were dangerous and heat treated products should be used from now on.
1983 was really a wasted year in terms of preventing this. It's strongly my belief that had action been taken, that my dad would not have been infected with HIV. And in that scenario, it's most likely that he'd still be alive today. It didn't have to happen.
With discovery of both the virus and this new process, we now have a blood test for AIDS. We should be able to prevent transfusion-related AIDS cases, as well as those that might appear in haemophiliacs.
For the first time in October 1984, the HIV blood test, as we now know it, was made available to us. So one day, I batched up blood samples from 35 regularly treated patients from my center and sent them off for HIV testing. ...35 brown envelopes came back, and I opened them one by one, and all but one of them were positive. Our centre was the same as everybody else around the country, with 80 to 90% of regularly treated patients testing positive. Many of these patients who were positive were children. The youngest of our patients was 4. There were some families with 2 children who were both sons, both haemophiliacs, both with HIV. Over the next few months, I sat down with the parents in a room and told this child that they had HIV and what that was likely to mean. All of the centres would have had results in October 1984. And they then had to make a decision, what are we going to do with these results? The blood test, this was, of course, an antibody test. It wasn't a test for the virus. So if you were testing antibody positive, it meant you had met HIV. We didn't know whether you still had HIV or whether you were immune to it. So the initial advice was, while we're trying to work out what it does mean, that maybe you shouldn't tell patients. No central advice, no standardised advice. Each haemophilia centre did, I think, what it thought was best.
The do not tell policy was reduced to writing in the minutes of the notes of the top people in 1984. It's a clear demonstration that they actively withheld knowledge from haemophiliacs that they tested at the time.
In the December of 1984, you can see there was discussion going on between the directors and Department of Health about whether or not to even tell the patients of their HIV status.
It says,
several differing views were expressed. Dr. Kernoff, who was at the Royal Free Haemophilia Centre, he says here, it may be considered irrelevant if one tells or doesn't tell the results of the testing. I think the patients, any person would argue that it's entirely relevant whether or not you're infected with HIV, so that's just an absurd mentality. They say that a study of the haemophiliac population would provide the invaluable material to increase their knowledge of the disease. They believe a study could be regarded as a research project, and they say patients who have asked for their HIV results should be informed of them. Otherwise, it's up to an individual director to decide whether or not to tell the patient.
The results of those tests were very often not communicated to the person from whom the blood had been taken for years. And then when they found out, they couldn't believe it.
There are records in my notes of tests that were done in 84 and 85 saying that I was positive, but I wasn't told until 88. That not only did that put me at risk, it put partners at the time, during that 4-year period, at grave risk. But that's what happened.
September 84, they were checking his blood without telling us. We didn't know he was being tested for HIV at all. We'd never given permission for anything. We were never asked.
We believe they knew by 1983. My father wasn't told till February 1985. In between that time, and my father had had another child, how he never passed that HIV across to his wife or my brother, it just beggars belief, it really does. They were so lucky.
You know, I thought it was right to test and then right to tell. I mean, for heaven's sake, if it's positive, not only has it got profound implications for the patient, but also for their sexual partners. So I think if a patient was tested and then not told the result, or not told that they'd had the test, I obviously do think that was wrong.
We were asked to go up to the Haemophilia Centre one lunchtime, and it was odd. I was in the first group of five called in. Things went quiet, we all settled down, and we knew it was coming, because we knew it was coming. Dr. Alan Sam just picked up his hat and went calmly, with some tears up in his eyes, saying, "You have, you haven't, you have, you haven't, you have got HIV." The terror that day has never left me. I think about it probably every other day. A friend of mine to my right said, "So how long have we effing got then?" They said they didn't know. They would do our the best for us. They would give us their best treatment. Specialist, it's irrelevant. When you hear the words HIV, you're dead.
In June 1985, we went in on a normal routine
visit.
And the consultant was there, and there was another person there. And we sat down, and he said, "Just got to tell you that Lee's HIV positive, that Lee had been infected by his Factor VIII." I can remember saying, "What happened?" That's what I wanted to know, what had happened. I shouted at him because I was so angry. He never saw us again.
That was the last we've seen of him, yeah.
And your world just collapsed around you. And you're supposed to just go out and carry on as though nothing's happened.
In recent months, the killer disease AIDS has started to take a deadly toll among haemophiliacs in Britain. Over half have been infected with the AIDS virus after being treated with a National Health Service-supplied clotting agent, Factor VIII, designed to cure their blood disorder. Last Friday, the Department of Health estimated that 2,500 haemophiliacs have been infected by the AIDS virus as a result of using imported Factor VIII. AIDS has become the greatest public health danger since World War II.
I feel terrible as one of the men who had to prescribe that treatment, of course, unknowingly, that this virus was contaminating it. I think if government had really put its money where its mouth was many years ago and really given the blood transfusion service of this country what it needed and what it wanted, they would have only had British products, and all the evidence is that those were predominantly safe.
While you've been Minister of Health, we've continued to import more and more of the product from these dubious donors.
That's right, because it's the only available source. Without Factor VIII, obviously, the haemophiliacs would be at even more serious risk.
This was the very darkest of times, really. People were starting to get sick and die. There was no treatment. There was no centralised support. You just felt alone with your fellow treaters across the country, trying to do the best that you possibly could.
The AIDS crisis was the most difficult times of my life. When the doctors told you not to share that information, you had to keep it quiet. You had to live a lie. It's like a black hole you were pulled in when you wanted to be out. Whenever you buy something now, you question the quality of the product. Why didn't I question it then? I'm one of the oldest haemophiliacs. There were haemophiliacs younger than me who were co-infected, you know, 20 years younger. And you think, well, if I had just started asking questions beforehand, at least one of them would have been saved, in the sense that, you know, not saying that they passed away, but they wouldn't have had the same journey as me. And for me, that would have been enough.
In the next 2 to 3 years, people were falling victim to the stigma of AIDS. They were losing their jobs. They could no longer get mortgages, life insurance. They had been financially ruined. The pressure for compensation really began to mount. And that's when we kind of see the HIV litigation get off the ground. The case was alleging that the government and the health authorities were negligent. It really was a David versus Goliath battle.
Surely, Mr. Speaker, they would urgently compensate haemophiliacs who have contracted the HIV virus.
Here, the government has bowed to pressure from MPs and agreed to give £19 million to a fund for haemophiliacs who contracted the HIV virus from contaminated blood.
Because we have established the principle of ex gratia, non-means tested, lump sum payments.
What we received was never compensation, it was an ex gratia payment, which I looked up, actually, and it's Latin for the word do favour. So basically, the government were doing us a favour. That's how they viewed it.
My honest feelings, I've sat in this meeting and I've heard an award of money and I feel like a prostitute. I feel I've sold my body for a pathetic 20 pieces of silver. And I feel I've had no help towards the root and branch of what's happening to my situation at all.
I think we've reflected the widespread public shock which we all feel when we hear of this awful sequence of events. We've left on one side the question of legal responsibility. That's a matter for the courts. I don't believe the government is liable. I don't believe that the health service is legally liable for what occurred. It's an appalling tragedy and just a consequence of the spread of AIDS in America and the then state of knowledge and about blood products and the availability of the blood products some years ago.
That litigation was very, very difficult to pursue. Very little was known about what had happened within the seat of power at the time.
The government's argument is that the Haemophiliacs case simply isn't strong enough to justify releasing confidential policy documents. They say to do so would be against the public interest.
In the October of 1990, it's quite interesting to look at what was being said publicly and what was being said privately. Ken Clark, he did an interview on the radio. We have the transcript, and he says, they don't actually, in my opinion, have a claim. But privately, things were slightly different. Just a few weeks after the radio interview, in this private Treasury letter, it says, Mr. Clark then commented that some of the cases against health authorities were very strong and were in fact straightforward medical negligence cases. So when you contrast that to what he was saying to the general public on the radio, it really couldn't be any more different. There's a letter here from within the Treasury from November 1919. They're talking about the legal opinion on the case. Say here that counsel's latest assessment of the risks in fighting the cases through the courts, though not precisely quantified, is apparently somewhat less confident than 2 months ago. They say there seems a considerable danger that courts would bend over backwards to make awards to as many haemophiliacs as possible. They say, I understand from the Department of Health that there are more than 500 sufferers who might in principle have contracted the virus after the stage at which hospitals might reasonably have been expected to use different forms of treatment, which could be heat-treated material when that was available and people received non-heat-treated material. And as we go through, here we have public statements from Ken Clark and others saying, we're not responsible, there's nothing to this legal case. And then we have the document showing what happened internally. So those two things are at odds with each other. At the end of 1990, that's when Margaret Thatcher exited Number 10, John Major was the new Prime Minister, and that's where we see the litigation came to an end.
Good evening. The headlines at 6 o'clock. The government is to give another £42 million in compensation to haemophiliacs infected with the HIV virus through contaminated blood products.
The settlement was out of court, and it was a global settlement. There was no admission of responsibility.
I'm now able to tell the House that the government has been examining this matter and has been able to agree in principle to proposals put forward by the plaintiff's lawyers.
On the radio, it said the haemophiliacs were going to be given some financial settlement, and so there was talk about money in the air. It was built up to a crescendo, and it was an absolute anticlimax when the whole thing was settled. We realised it was just hush money, you know, keep quiet and just take money and stop making a noise. And as the days went, that's how we felt.
In in order to put a belt and braces on it, the Department of Health required the claimants to sign a waiver, which meant that they would never sue the Department of Health again for in similar circumstances.
We kept refusing to sign it, but the solicitor who was acting for us at the time kept phoning, didn't she? And then we had letters saying that if we didn't sign it, nobody, none of the haemophiliacs would get anything. We all had to sign it.
When you speak to victims and families, almost all of them say the same thing. People were effectively pressured into signing that waiver.
And we're told in no uncertain terms that if you don't sign this waiver, no one will get anything if you don't sign this waiver. You've all got to sign it.
My uncle was dying of HIV at the time, and his family wouldn't have received any money. So we signed it. Should have read it, I think, a bit more carefully.
This is basically the part of the waiver which explains what people are foregoing, and it says here, I undertake not to bring any proceedings against the Crown or any health service body now or at any time in the future in respect of the said infection of the person's name by human immunodeficiency virus or hepatitis viruses. And that or hepatitis viruses part would be really key.
In 1989, non-A, non-B was isolated as hepatitis C. We now know that the incidence of hepatitis C in US donor plasma in the 1970s was at least 1%. So if you were being treated with factor VIII from 20,000 American blood donors and 1 in 100 had hepatitis C, there was absolutely no way you could not get hepatitis C.
This is an internal Department of Health memo, and in 1989, there's this knowledge that most recipients of factor VIII are hepatitis C positive. In here on the second page, we see it says, in relation to hepatitis C, most haemophiliacs at risk would develop hepatitis after the first or second exposure to product. This continues into December of 1989. They're saying if you've got chronic hepatitis, which is in 50% of cases, they're saying at this point, you've got a 10-year survival average. Bearing in mind that this is in 1989, so this is kind of before the waiver, well before the litigation's been settled. And somehow, years after this, everyone signs their rights away.
Those hepatitis risks were well known and established within the medical community. Now, to your average patient, your average person with haemophilia who's actually going to use the product, they didn't have awareness of that.
79 at college was when I wasn't well. My roommate, he says, oh, do you know, Suresh, I think your eyes look a bit yellow, you know? And I said, no, I can't be. It must be the light or something. He says, no, they definitely look yellow. You don't look right. And I went to the nurse, and she said, oh, what they do a bit? Yeah, we've been expecting this. I mean, we just carried on taking it because we thought that the doctors were doing the best, you know? From the notes, the very first factor VIII that I had was contaminated with non-A, non-B hepatitis, which they subsequently found out to be hepatitis C. They didn't tell me that I was hepatitis C positive till 1993. And by then, they made us sign this waiver. And bearing in mind that my liver function test had been questionable since 1978, and they knew that this was in the blood, and they'd known for quite some time.
This all culminates really into what is one of the absolute most key documents that I've come across. And these are the minutes of a meeting of Haemophilia Center directors and Department of Health officials in February of 1990. Its primary purpose from the minutes was to discuss the ongoing litigation. During the litigation, the Haemophilia Society have made a request to the Haemophilia Center directors about what's the situation with hepatitis. Is this something we need to be concerned about? They say, after further discussion, the Haemophilia Society should not be given hepatitis data. Then following that, in February 1991, and this is a letter by part of the secretariat of this committee called the ACVSB, the Advisory Committee on the Virological Safety of Blood, a high-level committee that was making decisions and giving advice directly to ministers on issues pertaining to blood safety. And so he writes to the officials saying, "I believe that any that are HIV positive would have to agree not to raise hepatitis in any further litigation." Now all the haemophiliacs are going to sign a waiver when they're accepting the HIV settlement. When I look at this, to me, this shows how the government hid the truth of hepatitis C from the claimants in the group legal action. Essentially, it's a cover-up, it's a stitch-up, and prevented them from seeing any sense of justice.
The worst thing about signing that was 3 months afterwards we were told that we had hepatitis C. They waited. Of course, they waited.
So, you know, we were all railroaded at some point, weren't we?
Oh, that's a vague way of putting it. We were definitely railroaded. We had no choices. There was no choices.
Is hepatitis C has had a huge impact on us. It was 6 years ago now. Barry was getting cirrhosis of the liver was quite bad, and that was really becoming quite a problem. And then they diagnosed liver cancer. So it was a case of a liver transplant or you would die, basically. I get very, very down. I was working for the NHS and I was also doing bank work and agency work and anything I could get. I ended up in a debt management programme because I owed £40,000. I'd been getting one credit card to pay off another. Just to keep going. I'm tired of fighting this. I'm tired of getting somebody just to say sorry. Basically, for messing up so many people's lives.
I think it's when you look back over it all, it makes it, it feels, but if, that's why I tend not to look backwards.
Hundreds of people died over the next few years, and it was forgotten about. The families were left to just struggle on And that was that, as far as the government and the public perception was concerned.
We had all been forgotten. Mm. We weren't a story anymore, nobody was interested. As you rightly said, everyone just believed that it had been sorted out.
Yeah, there was nothing. We were swept under the carpet and made to keep quiet, really. We didn't see anywhere else to go.
Well, I realise I've been part of the greatest medical disaster to have affected the NHS. Of my 35 patients that we treated regularly, I think there are about 5 left alive now. It's very powerful when you get involved in a situation where people die as a result of the treatment that you've given them in good faith.
The state is a murderer, says this woman. Her son is dying of AIDS. She believes the sentences passed today were too lenient.
There were prostitutions, first in France, and the level of culpability which was attributed to individual people in France was quite horrendous.
In France, they sent out Factor VIII that they knew to be contaminated.
The very state itself is on trial for, in their words, murdering haemophiliacs.
The trial here has raised wider questions about political accountability and the whole relationship between ministers and their civil servants.
No one could go back. If you try and sue again, you'll be struck out of court within hours. And that's the problem which faced pretty much everyone over 30-odd years.
I'd like to see the ones involved held accountable. And I mean held accountable, not a slap on the wrist. Gradually, as he got older, he would ask questions and I would always be honest with him because I had to be honest with him. That's just, I couldn't lie to him.
And I think he even told you he knew he was going to die in the end.
He used to say how frightened he was. He was scared, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And you can't change it, you can't take it away. What could you do?
Merry
Christmas to you. All right? Stomachy. You got stomachy?
I'm
going to
sleep.
Trying to
listen.
I'm going to be cheerful. It was only a short life. 10 years.
Good 5 of them. Hell.
There was more going wrong than can be explained. You get something wrong, you take the blame. You get something wrong and someone dies and you don't own up to it for 40 years and you pretend that it's a society running properly. It's not.
From what I know, I believe that this scandal amounts to a criminal cover-up on an industrial scale.
I'm never in favour of conspiracy theories, but when I found that my own papers when I was Minister of Health were no longer available to me in 87, because apparently under a 10-year rule they had all been scrapped, I was pretty suspicious.
A minister's papers destroyed without his consent under something that they called the 10-year rule. I've been a minister, I've never heard of the 10-year rule. Have you, Madam Deputy Speaker? I say it to everybody, people who are here in this House today, people who are candidates who may be coming here, you must act on this information. You cannot leave this where it is.
A wide range of documents have gone missing, be it minutes of meetings, departmental memos. You very often find that you're reading through a file and just at the point which it's getting interesting, it stops.
The government have been telling us that all the documents are in the public domain or are available in the archives, but Jason's Freedom of Information Act sort of searching has proved that that's not the case.
These are destruction receipts from the Department of Health. The destruction of documents, it went in waves over sort of a 5-year period between 1993 and 1998. And those waves of destruction seem to come at kind of key times. Right at the end of 1992, we've got people going to jail in France for their role in the blood scandal. And then right at the beginning of 93, for the first time ever, an MP, Alf Morris, raises the issue of compensation for haemophiliacs infected with hepatitis C in the House of Commons. And on that very same day, a number of these ACVSB volumes are closed, the files are closed, and they're sent for a review in 5 years' time. Just a few months later, in the July of 93, those volumes are actually destroyed. There are these two other events that happen. Around the 8th and 9th of October 1997, in Canada, a civil court had found in favour of haemophiliacs who are infected with HIV. And then we see just less than a week after that case is won in Canada, and we've got six volumes of papers, again, of ACVSB files that have been destroyed. I think you've got to ask yourself, is this just coincidence, or is there something more to it than that? There's no hard evidence that this was the decision-making which led to these documents being destroyed, but when you look at the timeline, it's difficult to believe that there isn't some relation there. Documents of this significance relating to an issue where thousands of people have been seriously harmed. That's the kind of documentation that should be stored forever in the National Archives.
I'm afraid that this is necessary to ask that the recommendations remain confidential, largely because of the commercial implications. It was clear that there was a link between blood, blood products, HIV and AIDS, and that that link had been identified at that time in the late spring of 1983. And it was Jason's efforts over two or three years putting those building blocks together which got us where we are today.
These are the documents that I'd spent hundreds of hours kind of distilling down into some kind of simple story with how I thought we could get it back in court. Those were Committee on Safety of Medicines minutes, documents about keeping information confidential due to commercial implications, how there was knowledge of hepatitis C, and how there was a conscious effort not to let patients know. I kind of just see myself as the cog of the bigger campaign machine and all those people that had died before me. But it's all this information, all these documents that allow us to get this back into the court.
It was after we saw these documents, we wrote to the Department of Health and then linked all this to the death of Jason's father. We've imagined that we'd get a very, very strong response from the Department of Health saying, you're totally wrong, retract what you're saying, but no, they didn't. They came back to us and said, we want more time.
Yes.
They're documents. Yes, you could barely go through any piece of this material without finding something which would be totally damning to their position. I mean, it shows that what they were doing, how they did it, what they knew they were doing, and how they tried to conceal it. This is 83 was the start of the concealment.
I'd been working with the Daily Mail on a story, and we had timed that so that that happened on the same day that, Des lodged the group legal action with the High Court. And a week to the day later, Theresa May says, hey, here's your public inquiry.
Literally half an hour before an emergency debate here in the House of Commons was due to begin, Downing Street suddenly announced that there would be a public inquiry into the tainted blood scandal.
The victims and their families have suffered pain and hardship, and they deserve answers. And the inquiry that I've announced today will give them those answers.
I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by Almighty God. The evidence I shall give
shall be the truth.
Shall be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
In terms of scale, this will be the biggest public inquiry of its time that's ever been held in the UK. It promises to deliver a lot, and I really hope that they do. I really hope that they do. I would hate to get to the end of this and for the conclusion to be, it's all very sad, but...
Will anybody get into trouble over this? I doubt it. They'll still carry on covering it up as much as they can to protect the ones that did it.
You know, it's the most profound medical disaster ever to have hit the National Health Service. We should have heard a lot more about it. The whole epidemic has been relatively understated in Britain.
A lot of my friends died wanting answers to certain things that happened, things that changed the course of history for a huge number of people. So why don't you just face the truth and just say, well, this is what happened. You know, we made certain mistakes, and just be truthful and be honest.
The truth has to be laid out, not someone else's version of it. The truth.
We regard ourselves as the civilized part of the world because we know right from wrong, and we put in place safeguards to make sure that, that's carried through. But we didn't. We allowed commercial interests to become more important than they should have done. difficult questions have got to be asked from pharmaceutical companies, senior civil servants, and politicians.
I find it hard to believe that there can be so many coincidences to point towards foul play and for none to exist. I think there has been an orchestrated cover-up, and they almost got away with it.